So I'm Julie Pfeiffer, and I'm here hosting for on behalf of the Adult Ed Committee here at Fourth Presbyterian Church. So thrilled to see everyone here. We've got a great program. I am not going to introduce this program. I will pass the baton off to Andrea Denny. And then after that, Lucy will give us an opening prayer, and then we will launch into the program. But what I did want to do is make a plug for our program next Sunday, which is going to be presented at the same time, and it is on the art and faith of the nativity scene. We are going to be having Kyle Mathers here, who is the manager and curator at the Loyola University Museum of Art, and he's going to be talking about the Govan collection of creches that they have there. And that actually, the exhibit is open until next Sunday, so just letting you know, we are having a program on it, but if you are wanting to go and look at the exhibit on the creches, it will be open through next Sunday. But with that, I will pass this off to Andrea.
Thank you. Good morning. And on behalf of the Property Committee, I want to welcome you to this class on the restoration of the Frederic Clay Bartlett murals in our sanctuary. And by way of a little history, I want to tell you how we got to this place, not all the way back from when they were painted. I'll start sooner. So back in 2019, the Property Committee spent an entire summer walking all through the Fourth Church campus, interior and exterior, and making note of all of the issues that would need to be corrected. And at that point, they noted there were a couple of corners on these murals that were starting to come loose. We documented that there were two. Now, as so many of our stories begin, then came COVID. And so fast forward to 2022, and we noticed we had 9 corners that were coming undone, and they were actually starting to bend over. And I walked in, I'm like, oh. So if you'll see there, it's kind of folded over. That's what we were starting to notice. And this became a very urgent project for the Property Committee to take over. So the Property Committee formed a subcommittee, and it was brilliantly led by Liz Patterson, and she's here today, and Cherie Lundeen, and Les Vinch, Leshit Pitka, and myself. And we started by digging through archives and then talking to people who've been around for a long time to understand what they had done and remembered. And then we asked 6 different firms to submit proposals. And it became very clear that Parma Conservation was the best partner for us for a variety of reasons, but not least of which they had just finished the restoration at Second Presbyterian Church on those Frederic Clay Bartlett murals. And did stellar work. We had stellar recommendations from them, and it absolutely bore out for us as well. I love how they approach it with both the art and the science behind it. They were really wonderful communicative partners. And then my favorite compliment for anyone is on time, on budget. And they were. So I am pleased to welcome Elizabeth Kendall and Peter Schoenmann. Did I get close?
Yeah, that's great.
Okay. I've been practicing his name. They are the principals of Parma Conservation, and they're going to take us through both the art and the science of this project. But first, I will welcome Lucy to pray us in. So Peter and Elizabeth, thank you for your work, and we're excited for what you have to say.
Thank you, Andrea, and thank you for your diligence in holding and preserving this incredible jewel of a place that we call Fourth Church. So let's pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks for this day. We give you thanks for the beauty of our lives and also the beauty of the world. And in particular, we give you thanks for the beauty of these murals. We know, oh God, that sometimes your deepest expression is through the arts, that you come to us through the visual beauty of our sanctuary, of the murals, of the way that our lives are touched by you through these expressions. And so this day, be with us and guide us in all that we do and say, and we give you thanks for your sustaining presence through this church, through Christ. Amen. So do you need another? Peter's got a mic, so where's Julie? Because sometimes, are we going to do a Q&A? Okay, great.
Well, hello, everyone. Can I start? I think so. So I don't know how many of you know about conservation, but I thought that maybe we would start talking about it. Being charged with the care of irreplaceable artwork is an awesome responsibility. You know, as professional conservators, we're asked to do this literally all the time. It takes an abundance of care, but you'd be surprised how many people still think that a conservator is the same as being a really good artist. They see brighter colors and they ask, did you just paint that? So today I'm going to talk a little bit about the responsibility and care that goes into our profession, as well as the care that went into conserving the beautiful murals in your sanctuary by Frederic Clay Bartlett. I hope to inform you about what a conservator actually does, the challenges a conservator may face, and the preparation and planning that goes into each project to ensure success. Bear with me, I've got dual laptops here, so I'm going to see how this works. Yeah, I can't advance the slide. Oh, here we go. Not sure. Okay. All right. Great. Thanks. All right. Sorry about that. So a conservator is concerned with getting to the truth and conserving the original artwork of the artist. So we design treatments that will improve and stabilize, compensate for damage, and stay within ethical boundaries. We want to be as minimal as possible in our interventions, respecting the life and history of the original work. And like patients, no two artworks are alike. And like doctors, a conservator is bound by oath to the American Institute for Conservation to do no harm. So there's a lot of preparation. We observe, we test, and in the lab, we use analytical tools like this infrared image, which is showing us in this 17th century English panel painting, the underdrawing that was done in charcoal by the artist. And you can see abrasions in the gesso panel. Those are those white marks that you can see periodically. Yeah, let me see if I can get this pointer to work. Does that work? I can't see the pointer. You see it? All right, well, I can't. But anyway.
I'm just gonna point out some areas like this. See all these scratchy areas. That's damage in the panel that we would not be able to see without that analytical technology. Similarly, we use ultraviolet light to see things that we would otherwise not see. In this example on the left, it's revealing past restoration by somebody else. So in the daylight, it looks absolutely perfect. And in the black light, it looks kind of freakish. And we also use x-rays. So x-rays are really neat. The x-rays, if they meet a dense pigment, they can't penetrate. And if it's a lighter pigment, it'll go through and expose the film. So you get this really unique image that's developed, and you can see things that you would never see otherwise. In this example, we're seeing a paint loss across her face there. There's a tear in the painting to her left. And of course, sometimes you find paintings that literally are quite different than what you're seeing in the daylight, and completely different paintings underneath. So, you know, we don't have an opinion as to authentication usually. We leave that up to authenticators, but something fishy going on with this painting. That's all I'll say. And it's also useful to know something about the artist who created the work that you're going to be treating. And that brings us to today's subject, Frederic Clay Bartlett. So here he is at the young age of 33 in 1906. He's an accomplished muralist and easel painter in Chicago. He's a celebrity, actually, by the standards of the day. You know, he came from a rich and influential family, but he sort of eschewed his privilege. He wanted to make it as an artist by his own merit, and he actually did that. When he was 19, he was one of the few American students to be accepted to the Royal Academy of Art in Munich. He spent time in Paris and was a pupil of James McNeill Whistler, which is really impressive. He was also able to meet and befriend the French master muralist, I'm going to butcher this name, Pierre Puvis de Chavannes, who personally encouraged Bartlett to pursue a career in mural painting. And that brings us to around 1900. He's kind of settled back in Chicago. He's married. And at the turn of the 20th century, it was a good time to be a mural painter. There was something going around the whole country, actually, major cities, called the City Beautiful Movement. This is where influential urban planners would get together with architects, and they try to create spaces for the community in community centers, civic centers, libraries, you know, and I'll include churches as, you know, congregation centers. This was a unique time when architects partnered up with really talented muralists to decorate their interior architecture. So Frederick's father, Adolphus, you know, he was a very successful businessman, industrialist. I believe he founded the company that became True Value Hardware Stores. So he had a lot of connections and he knew a lot of people. And he knew the architect, Howard Van Doren Shaw. So when Second Presbyterian Church needed its murals, Shaw went ahead and hired Frederic Clay Bartlett to paint the Tree of Life mural. And so it was his first major mural project in the city, and it was completed in 1903. Following that, Bartlett received other mural commissions throughout Chicago that some of you have heard of. Can you hear me? At the University of Chicago, the University Club in Chicago, the Fine Arts Building in Chicago, and a few others. And he was commissioned again by Howard Van Doren Shaw, along with Ralph Adams Cram, who designed the sanctuary here at Fourth Presbyterian Church, to paint murals in the lateral naves. The we are calling them the bays, and that Andrea had mentioned. That brings us up to speed. But he painted those in 1914, and he was asked to complement the Gothic Revival style. So for many of Bartlett's murals, especially those at Second Presbyterian and Fourth Presbyterian Church, Bartlett preferred painting in what's known as the Pre-Raphaelite style. So this style is an homage to basically pre-Renaissance art, right? So just think of art during the Middle Ages. Think of monks, you know, lovingly, devotionally illuminating manuscripts, and think of these same monks like, you know, lovingly working on a panel painting and tooling marks into it and carving the framework out of one piece of wood. Something about the process of making the artwork is what the Pre-Raphaelites also appreciated. And certainly in pre-Italian Renaissance art, you had a lot of panels that had this raised relief. This we call it in conservation, we call that bas-relief. The Italians call it basso rilievo, or they just say rilievo. So it was an important aspect of religious paintings in the pre-Renaissance period. And this is an example of a 14th century Italian painting that shows exactly that. We have a relief called low relief, which is actually the tooling or the punch marks that make the halo. And that those are actually incised in the gesso preparation of the panel. And then you have sort of a middle relief, which is the arch. And that's hand-carved wood that's attached to the panel. And this was all gilt in what we can assume is 23 karat, Italian gold. And it's intended to exalt and convey the idea of divinity or saintliness. Very important to religious art. So it's interesting to note that Bartlett is the only American muralist we know, who worked in bas relief. There was another artist around at the time, but we consider him an expatriate. He goes by the name of John Singer Sargent. And so this is an example of Sargent's bas relief at the Boston Public Library. And Sargent spent, from between, I think, 1895 to 1915, painting a series, a mural cycle entitled The Triumph of Religion. And it's striking to me how similar the bas relief is, especially the halos in Sargent's work and the work at Fourth Presbyterian Church here of Bartlett and his halos and some of the other medallions and things that are decorating the painted canvases. I'd like to think that they knew each other. They both belonged to a club at the time that was called the National Society of Mural Painters. They were both members. But I cannot find any evidence that they had ever met. And of course, Sargent died a year after Bartlett completed the murals here in the sanctuary. So who knows? But that's where we begin here at Fourth Presbyterian Church. And as Andrea mentioned, we were contacted in early 2023 because the murals were looking, they were in a dilapidated state. They were starting to fall off pretty quickly and they had to do something. So how this all came about, there was some water damage in this particular bay in the 90s. If I'm correct. And at that time, conservators came and addressed the issue. But some, 30 odd years later, it started to happen again. And so the first thing that we could do is set up a study period. Before we kind of touch murals, we need to learn as much as we can about the artwork. And we spent about a week analyzing all the different aspects of what was going on with the materials in the artistic materials and the substrate plaster, as well as the wooden frame. And we brought some of our analytical tools. UV light helped us identify the exact glue that was used in the 1990s. It's an organic glue. And then we did a little bit more testing and found that it was a starch. So put two and two together. Starch is not a very permanent glue. That's good in conservation. You don't want things to be permanent. At the same time, it's very apt to weaken with cycles of humidity and things like that. So over the course of 20 or 30 years, the glue just basically depleted by the power of the atmosphere, you know, changes, relative changes. Sometimes it's a little more humid, sometimes not. It doesn't seem that we did not find any leaks or anything obvious in that bay to indicate that there was any kind of water problem. The UV light also helped us notice things like past restoration. Similar to the slide I showed you earlier, this is a picture that reveals in painting, which is retouching by somebody else on the face of one of the angels. We also noted discrepancies from passage to passage. Here is, and Bartlett loved to make mirror images in his murals. So this is a mirror image of one angel in foliage to the next, and they're so different. The one on the left has a lot of chiaroscuro. It has a lot of volume, you know, it's light and dark. The one on the right is painted rather flat. So once again, we see something different like that, and we think, there's something going on here. And certainly we wanted to compare it with the other murals in the sanctuary, which we did. And it did seem that the other murals in the sanctuary had a little more shadow, light and dark, especially in the robes. And in the bay that we were working, the angels didn't have heavy shadows. They almost looked like they were missing shadows. Other peculiarities in the gold on the right. I'm sorry, I don't know if I can get this pointer. There's an area of gold that's much brighter than this side, which has sort of a green tinge to it. So this was, the green tinge is actually a paint that was put on by someone at some time. It seemed to be older than the 1990s, so we can only speculate that maybe there was another decorating campaign in the church at some point in the past, but you know, it's nice to have exact dates, but it's not critical. We just know what we have to do when we see discrepancies like that. There are also areas that were obviously abraded. So within this robe, you see that sort of scratchy vertical line work through some of the subtle tone there. That's actually missing paint. And usually that's caused by some sort of abrasive action, like somebody wiping a piece of artwork. And it could be from water also. You know, if at some point there was a lot of moisture behind that mural, that moisture could wick through the canvas and cause some damage. So of course, we did some cleaning tests, you know, solvents and certain water-based chemistry tells us a lot. Certain solvents can tell us what the makeup of certain materials are, their solubility, and that helps us characterize what overlying materials there may be on the murals, and you know what solutions we can come up with to safely remove one while leaving the other, or leaving the paint layer alone. Certainly, that's our job. So this type of process we do sort of stepwise, if you will. You know, we start with weak solvents and we progressively increase the bite. It could be a water-based thing. It could be a hydrocarbon thing. It just depends on what you're dealing with. Everything is different. We like to use chemicals and solvents that are rather weak, and instead, we like to use a weak solvent and put it with a compress so it doesn't evaporate. That way we can use time as an element. You let it dwell, you let a weak solvent really dwell for a while. And this one was very, very weak, but the results were very astounding, because you can see here, we're dwelling our solvent, and minutes later, it's taken off this past restoration, which we didn't even know was past restoration, to reveal Bartlett's original highlights that he had intended the whole time. So that was exciting. Further down the road in testing, we find areas that seem, you know, really, really dirty. And, you know, it becomes obvious that there's parts of the mural that were never cleaned and parts of the mural that were partially cleaned. So it's sort of a hodgepodge of things and a lot of cooks in the kitchen over the years, for whatever reason, they had to address. So once we're comfortable with our chemistry, with, you know, how we understand the artwork is going to respond to certain solvents, then we make a bigger mock-up. And during our test or study phase, that's what we did. And, you know, I felt confident enough. I said, okay, I'm going to go where this paint is already abraded, you know, because if we can't do it here, you know, maybe we don't have any business doing it anywhere else. You know, this was an area that we had to be exceptionally gentle and careful with, not only because it had been previously damaged, but because what was left behind, those shadows were so faint. They were so thin that, you know, you could lose them very easily if you didn't have the right solution. But instead we were right. And, you know, the result was impressive. If you look at these photos, it looks like somebody opened a window and a beam of light is coming across the murals, right? So we determined from this also that it wasn't just dirt, or, you know, our solvents told us it was taking too long for it to be just dirt. In fact, there was a coating that was put on these murals, probably in the 90s, we think, and likely it contained some form of plastic, like a little bit of acrylic or a little bit of polyester. But the solution was discerning enough that the thinly painted shadows were still preserved. And indeed, the sun seemed to come out. And I just briefly explained too that the image on the right is a mock-up after cleaning of what we can do with our water thin retouching. So we go in to where you see some highlights or the old abrasions, and we use special conservation pigments and color match them to a T, so that when we, you know, do our retouching and we're finished, it looks like there was never any damage. But it's very technical controlled, and you have to be very precise, and you have to have a hand, and that takes some time to learn, like decades. So there was a momentary concern that perhaps Bartlett intended them to have a darker cast. There was an article in the Chicago Tribune from the time when he painted, and I forget her name, but I think it was a gossip columnist came and you know, was watching Bartlett and was like, "Oh, you know, well, it looks like he's going up and maybe darkening up a little bit," or something like that. And we just didn't buy that at all. He was just going through his process. But we had known from working at Second Presbyterian Church, after cutting through this darkened ambered mastic varnish, we saw these incredibly vibrant colors. And once you see that was the artist's intention, you can't think that he would want anything else. Oh, I didn't know if this would play, but this is a quick sort of before and after of what he wanted versus what happens over time. And that's just time and age and discoloration, the accumulation of life. But getting back to here, you know, we got the go ahead, we got the okay, we wrote the report and we forged ahead. There was a lot of work to accomplish in about 8 weeks. So we continued to clean with the compress cleaning that I showed, and it worked on both coated areas, if you will, and uncoated areas, because we could just adjust the time that we left the compress on. As for the peeling canvases, there ended up being more interventions than just 9. Anywhere that we saw a delamination is where there's a little bit of bubble or there isn't a good contact between the canvas and the wall. That's a time where we have to actually get a little invasive and pull a little more off so that we can put a proper conservation adhesive behind there. And, hopefully not have to worry about things in our lifetime as far as adhesion are concerned. We use a conservation product called Biva. And the Biva is it's a special thermoset resin. It activates at a specific temperature. And so what that does is allows somebody like a conservator to come in who's competent and knows what the tolerance of the resin. They can take that canvas off. They can reattach it. They can do anything. So it's very versatile. It's reversible. And that's sort of the name of the game in our profession. Certain of the areas with bas-relief, the bas-relief was oftentimes glued, sometimes tacked with nails directly through the canvas and into the plaster. But if the canvas were at all detaching or delaminating, then we had to temporarily stabilize with zip pulls, which is what we did because we didn't want to lose any of those precious plaster medallions or bas-relief, as we call it. If I can get this to play, I don't think I can. It's okay. So the gold, we, instead of trying to clean the gold where it obviously had been retouched with greenish paint, just from experience, we know that a gold pigmented paint is rather granular and doesn't hold up very well. So we just added more metallic grains. Basically, we found some metallic powders in a special wax, and you can melt that with solvents. And here Elizabeth is basically toning areas that were too dark or too light and making sure that everything is in balance. So you've got some of the gold that's original, you've got some of it that's been messed with, and we're tuning it so, you know, to bring it to the point that it's supposed to be. Oh, there she goes. Yeah, and if I had audio on this, we also had the added pleasure of listening to the pipe organ practice every day. And that was great, especially during right before Halloween. There were some really spooky, spooky organ sounds. And preservation varnish. So after we clean murals, we want to put on a product that is going to help protect them. And again, it has to be something that doesn't alter over time. You don't want it to be changing color after you've revealed such vibrant color. So it's low molecular weight. It's put on also as an ethical isolation layer for what Elizabeth is doing now, which is further retouching or in painting, as we call it. I like the term in painting because it says what it means. You know, you're putting paint sort of in where it needs to be and nowhere else, you know, thereby respecting as much of the original paint as possible. So we use little tiny brushes, and people can't believe it. They're like, you know, there could be damage everywhere, thousands of little dots. And weirdos like us, we're like, oh, goody, you know. That's how I feel anyway. So I'm going to end, kind of slow down at least to just show you some quick before and afters. So, you know, when you're working on something and you're making small changes over the course of many weeks, it's easy to forget where it came from. So I just found these really delightful to look at too, because it shows you know, the left side looks like a floor mat compared to the right side. Here again on the left is sort of the during cleaning phase. That's a really impressive cleaning window that Elizabeth made right down there. You can see the line, but then the finished product after conservation is on the right, and that's even more satisfying. Just the color shift from, you know, dingy to alive and vibrant. It makes our job so worthwhile, and it's so satisfying to, you know, fix all the little things. You know, we clean in every little nook and cranny. You can see these sort of cross shapes with the orange and black above the main panels. Those were satisfying. And the only thing I didn't like about the space is it was a little tight for photography. So, and I'm kind of particular about photography before and afters, and I wasn't able to really line anything up because, you know, I'm like, well, how the heck did I get that angle? And I'm looking at the same thing. So I'm just going to jostle between these, and you'll get the picture between, you know, the before dingy and in a distressed state, and then in its best state of conservation, probably seen in decades. So that's satisfying. A little closer view, some of the vibrancy that was restored, you know, through minimal tactics. And even closer. And, you know, we have to say we were thrilled to bring these murals back to what Bartlett had originally intended. And we thank you all. We thank 4th Presbyterian Church for inviting us and trusting us. And now I invite you to ask me any questions that you have. Yes.
The first one is about... did you put a little coating on the finished work?
Yes, we did.
Okay, and that I'm sure is very specialized, and you hope it lasts our lifetime, or how long?
Well, it's called a low molecular weight varnish. So the varnishes conservators use are very soft, and they can, if you know what you're doing, you can take them off with almost nothing. So we never advise after a conservation project that anyone but a conservator really be consulted and if it needs to be cleaned or even dusted.
So can you do that with a bigger brush then when you coat it?
Oh, sure.
Okay.
Yeah. So no, we use a varnish.
More efficient.
I wish I had gotten a picture of us varnishing with a bigger brush. Yeah, mm-hmm. But that is certainly you use a bigger brush.
And my second question is about resin. Well, actually, I have three questions. Resin, I'm only familiar with it for the violin. So what did you do with resin?
Oh, so Bartlett's murals at 2nd Presbyterian Church were coated with a resin, if that's maybe what you heard me say.
And resin isn't a good thing then?
Well, resin is just, dirt? You know, No, I mean, there's natural resins, which are saps, you know, from mm-hmm. trees, basically. And, you know, varnishes had been made from them for centuries. And then there are synthetic resins, which are made now, which some of them are very, very useful conservation products that we use. They're reversible, such as that adhesive that we use to glue the murals back onto the wall here. That's a conservation resin that activates at a specific temperature and reactivates at a specific temperature. So, sure.
The resin that you were talking about was at Second Presbyterian, and it was a resin that was put on in the 50s. And natural resins, in this case, it was a mastic, get very, very dark over time.
On a violin, it's okay because it's not going to hurt if a violin gets darker. But when it got darker, like in Second Presbyterian, all of the colors were masked and just looked brown instead of bright blue, bright green. Did that answer?
Yeah. My last question about this relief.
Yeah.
Boss relief. Excuse me, I'm a
musician. So I looked it up and it didn't really help me. It's the idea that it's not fully formed. It goes in.
Conservators call it bas relief. I've heard it called different things. I don't know. It's hard to, basso rilievo in Italian. I don't know if they're saying low or they're saying lesser.
I get it. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah, it's a lower relief. Yeah. So I guess you can have a range within there.
Yeah. I can confirm that about it being low. Bas is the French word for low.
Okay. No. Yes, sir.
I have a question about the paints, some the original paints. Mm-hmm. Are they still available?
Oil paint is, yeah.
Yeah, so they're all oils and the colors aren't from now toxic metals?
Most certainly some of them are toxic metals. The white that was used at that time was made from lead, yeah. So you have to be careful when you're doing our
even
job.
Even now, yeah.
Stupid question. These are the murals on the ceiling of the sanctuary, right?
Yes.
So how are we going to see them, Andrea? I can bring my candles in, but I don't think you want me to do that, do you?
Well, if you've been in church lately, you can look up and see them. Okay.
The buffets.
My question was also related to seeing the murals. I wondered if you were going to take this group through the church and point things out that you've done and done the conservation on. It would be very interesting to have you walk us through it when there's not a service going on.
Yeah. My wife and I both have laser pointers, so, that could work out. What's your question?
I was just wondering, so that is one bay. Have we looked at the other bays? And I have a feeling this one stands out. Actually, I know it stands out because my eye immediately went to it last Sunday. So just wondering, will we be able to brighten our other murals? And I just want to add, there's more Bartlett in this church than these arches. I just wanted to say there's a lot of Bartlett in other places too. Well, on the ceiling, on the beams, there's medallions. The angels were painted by Bartlett, designed maybe with Shaw, as I understand. I know a little, I don't know enough.
Interesting.
So in my introductory remarks, what I failed to do is thank the congregation for funding things like this, right? In the last couple of years, property has looked at what is it we need to do to conserve and restore our beautiful campus. And this is not an expensive work, as you might imagine, especially to hire people that are this qualified. But I will say, I am so pleased that Board of Trustees is letting us spend a little bit more money each year. And so we have funding for next year to do one more bay. And so our work is to work with Peter and Elizabeth to say, what is the one that needs our attention next? But it is, we have 16 bays of murals. And so we will continue to march along to restore what needs to be restored, keep holding intention, all that we need to do at this campus. This is, we don't want to ever lose that. And if we had unlimited time and money, then we would do all of them right now. But we will attend to the things that need attended to and kind of march around the building. Does that answer? We did one this year. We'll do one next year. We have 16 total.
And especially because I think there might be differences. Some of them have the angels and the detail. Others have some sort of, I don't know, design. And so I'm curious if the expense would be the same on all of those and how much. This one was really in bad shape. My understanding is they're not all as in bad shape, but what are we looking at?
So the less exciting parts of this are the scaffolding. Getting the scaffolding up to that area is a considerable expense of this project, right? And so I will say we spent $80,000 on this one bay, and I'm not going to get Peter and Elizabeth to lock in that price, but maybe we'll get close. But each one will be bid based on the work that's necessary. The other thing that makes this really complicated is they don't know what they're getting into until the scaffolding is put in place and they're up close and personal with it. Is that faithful to what you would answer? Okay, I don't want to speak for you.
Fairly similar, except for the, this had that added expense that many of the panels were delaminating, coming off. So there was a lot more to consolidate onto the wall. And we've seen other bays that have some of the canvases falling off, but I don't think any of them will be to this extent. We pray.
We pray.
Regan said, and I think this is important, if you're in the balcony, you can see it better. And I suppose you could go to the balcony and put your upper glasses on and maybe see more of this. And I have to say, it wasn't at all in the ballpark of what it costs to restore something. So that's amazing to me.
Any other questions?
Was the second press a fresco as opposed to a canvas, or was it also a canvas?
So the Tree of Life mural was painted directly on the wall, but the bays Bartlett had done on canvas, similar to these bays. So that's the major difference. But the Tree of Life mural was oil on wall, basically.
And so, did he do these angels, for example, on a canvas and then apply that in total? So it was, none of it was painted by scaffolding up there.
So actually, I do believe that he installed them, and I believe that he did some painting up there. Mm-hmm. But it would make sense that he could do a lot of the work in his own studio. So I wish we had a time machine and check it out, but I don't know. I'm sure there are probably some notes or letters somewhere.
Was his studio at that time in the Fine Arts Building?
I can't say for sure if he was still in the Fine Arts Building. I think he probably still had a studio. Mm-hmm. Well, but no, hadn't he married and built his home on Prairie Avenue by that time? Because he had his own studio there, mm-hmm. And I don't, yeah.
Dorfred.
Yeah, but he could have done all the work there too.
Okay, and one last question. Are all the notes about what you've done here going to be available to the conservators 100 sure. years from now?
Oh, definitely, definitely. I'll type this up and make sure that the church has a copy and a digital copy and a safe copy so that, you know, because it's very useful to have notes about what was done. Yeah. You know, it's very, very useful. And it's important to keep a record of what was done.
You had talked a little bit about the cleaning process, using careful selection of solvents.
Yeah.
Knowing that you didn't want to damage the original paint. Yep. Or the, mm-hmm. How did you go about the process of deciding what solvent to use without damaging the any of the mural?
It's stepwise. So, you know, you can narrow it down, you know, does it like water? Does it like oil? You know, oh, okay. Go to this. Okay. What can I do to make this mild? What does it like? Oh, let me test the pH. Let me dwell some deionized water and see what ions are on the surface of this paint layer. Okay. So we want to buffer to around there because that's cozy. That's comfortable. We don't want to go higher. We don't want to go lower because that might disrupt something. So that's how we do it. And we use, I think that our water-based technology, I didn't want to get in the weeds with all that, but I think it's probably the best in the city. I think that we can control the bite, if you will, through chelation, through ions or pH, and very, very accurately, and also through the mild cleansers that we use. You know, they're called low HLB surfactants, which they don't make a lot of soap, and the kind that we use actually denature. So after we use it, you want to rinse the surface, but if you don't get everything, it's just going to break down and you don't have to worry about saponification or anything like that. So. So that's a shop talk. You know, we talk about bite. You know, think about, I don't know if I should use that analogy. I was going to say a concrete floor, you know, that somebody has been hired to polish to a high polish, right? They go through cutters, and the first cutter is a rough, it's like sandy, you know. First is going to be rougher, and it's going to take more, and then get finer and finer and finer. So as conservators, we're interested in the fine stuff because a lot of cases we're looking at dirt that's, it's molecular, you know. When you get a accumulation of dirt that's less than a micron in diameter, it usually likes to make a hydrogen bond with the paint through the various salts that, you know, that are make up the pigments and other materials in the paint. So yeah, you need to know a little chemistry to be able to overcome that, you know, because you can't just break a hydrogen bond, for example. You have to do something else, and so that's what we do, and do no harm at the same time.
I love the science of it. That's really very cool. Huh. Mike, did you find any other restorations that happened? You said this was some of the restoration prior was 1990.
Yeah.
Was there earlier stuff too?
So we kind of suspected that some of it was earlier, you know, because there was just a lot of weird things. And we just didn't think all of those things could have happened at once. Lots of different colors in the gold, for example, different colors in the painted borders. Different browns, different touch-up paints. So, you know, it could have just been maintenance, you know, from decades and decades ago that nobody cared to record. I mean, you know, that happens all the time.
Uh, I just want to say that it's very easy to go to Second Press for a tour. You just use CTA Trip Planner and put in your address and put in 1928 South Michigan, which is a Cullerton. It may be the 3, it may be the 6, I don't know. But they have tours Saturday mornings and they have tours on Sundays after their service. You will see the beautiful Tree of Life. You will see incredible Tiffany stained glass windows and stained glass from many other artists. And you'll see the most beautiful baptismal font that I've ever seen. So do go down there. It's a wonderful thing, especially the Tree of Life. It's beautiful.
We actually have a couple of ladies here that wanted to talk about that. But before I do that, Karen, are there any other questions that relate to today's program? Okay, we'll take one more question.
I'm just curious about your training, obviously architecture, some chemistry.
I'm kind of unique. My wife is program trained, so she went through a school specifically for conservation. I kind of went the Cider House, what's that movie called? The Tobey Maguire route, if you will. Yes, I apprenticed. And I happen to have a lot of the requisite training already just by luck. I kind of lucked into it. I had gone to art school. I'd been to Italy. I worked in a coatings research lab, color matching, you know, for various coatings. And when I came to Chicago and I looked up an AIC fellow conservator and he saw my resume and he gave me a shot and I never looked back. And then I met someone even more brilliant who became my wife, and she's sitting right there. So together we're, I don't know, it's such a fun thing to me. I don't know, it's like being in school every day. You know, you have to do R&D every day for something, some aspect of a new job or project, so.
Well, Peter and Elizabeth, thank you. I think this has been fascinating and it's really opened people's eyes to what we have going, you know, the hidden gems that we have here in the church. But if you do want to continue kind of learning more about Frederick Clay Bartlett, and as was referenced, that we do have some gems down at Second Presbyterian Church. Mary Kay, Karen, did one of you ladies want to come up and?
Hi, I'm Karen Lamb. I'm a church member. You may not know me as well as you know Mary Kay Weisher.
Second Presbyterian Church has a nonprofit called Friends of Second Presbyterian. We have the president right here, Linda Miller. I'm on the board. I'm a docent. Mary Kay is a docent. We've seen the wonderful work that Parma has done, watched it. I climbed the scaffolding with Peter, but we are happy to give you tours. I know Claudia saying something was going to maybe arrange with Architecture Foundation, but I've left a little bit of information back there, some brochures. You can contact Mary Kay or myself, and we are happy to give you your own little tour, or come on Saturdays from 11 to 3, you can just show up, or Sundays after their church service. Mary Kay, do you want to say anything?
What about Fridays?
Well, we won't be doing Fridays after the end of the year. So, but yeah, and the spring will be open on Friday afternoons, but you just cannot believe the glorious work of this mural. He showed it there, and you can see it up close, and we have also bays with angels where you can see the body relief because you don't have to put your neck up so high. Thank you.
Thank you very much, ladies. And I think, is that one of the only churches on the National Historic Register here in Chicago? National, excuse me, oopsie, okay. All right, so once church lets out, I think Peter and Elizabeth are going to lead the group on a tour, or is that gonna be Andrea? Okay, whatever. So before you all go, I'm gonna send you off with a few words. I always tend to go and look online for things that other folks have written, which they can do much better than I can. So this is called a wishful prayer. So I'll read these words, send you off, and we'll go from there. But it's, God grant you the light of Christmas, which is faith, the warmth of Christmas, which is purity, the righteousness of Christmas, which is justice, the belief in Christmas, which is truth, the all of Christmas, which is Christ. And that is Wilda English. Don't know who she is, but I thought the words were very appropriate. So thank you all for coming. And what do you want them to gather at the back door?
Well, you know, I can turn the mic off.
Sure.
Yeah, we can
everybody
gather their coats, and I think what's church.